Hello and welcome to the episode 247 of What a Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. Today, we have the first recording session with Ringo, a couple of live gigs, and the filming of some promotional clips. On the 4th of September 1960, the Beatles, with Pete Best on drums and Stu Sutcliffe on bass, performed at the Indra Club in Hamburg, West Germany, for their first residency in town. 2 years later, in 1962, the Beatles flew to London to have their second parlophone recording session, the first with Ringo Starr on drums. The band arrived in Abbey Road just after lunch and between 2 and 5 p.m. rehearsed 6 songs in Studio 3. How Do You Do It and Love Me Do were certainly performed, with Tip of My Tongue, Ask Me Why, P.S. I Love You and Please Please Me other likely choices. After the rehearsal, George Martin took the lads to dinner and finally the recording session proper started. From 7 to 11:15 p.m., with 1 hour and 15 minutes of overtime, the band was to record Mitch Murray's How Do You Do It, which Martin had picked up to be the A-side of their first single, plus the Lennon-McCartney original Love Me Do for the B-side. The Beatles couldn't hide their disappointment with the A-side's choice. First of all, How Do You Do It was words apart from the rhythm and blues the band wanted to perform. They had heard the acetate demo version that Martin had sent them, and they had completely rearranged the number to make it sound a bit more like their usual offering. This didn't mean they had come to like the song, though. In addition to not liking How Do You Do It, both John Lennon and Paul McCartney really wanted that the singles released by the Beatles only featured original compositions. They felt it was an important calling card for the band, something that could make them different from other musical acts. With these premises, it shouldn't come to a surprise that the resulting recording session wasn't exactly successful. Paul was anxious over a last-minute change in the structure of Love Me Do, and Ringo decided to play the hi-hat with the maraca to play multiple percussions at the same time, something he had never tried before. In the end, George Martin ended up with a version of How Do You Do It that Dick James, publisher of the song, who would go on to become the Beatles' own publisher, judged inferior even to the demo acetate version that the Beatles had heard, and 15 takes of Love Me Do that didn't seem quite right. The session bore an important development, though. Although it was standard procedure for the A&R people of the label or the producer of a session to pick up the material for the band, George Martin decided that the lack of ambition that the Beatles had shown in recording How Do You Do It was a sign that perhaps it was best to let the lads have their way and record the material they had themselves picked up. It doesn't seem much today, but this was a decision of great foresight on Martin's behalf, and one that did change the record industry standard, allowing all the singles that the Beatles released throughout their career to be original compositions. 1963. To make up for the cancellation of their presence in several Mercy Beach showcase shows, Beatles manager Brian Epstein allowed promoter John Smith to book the band for 4 nights in a row. Tonight was the first, with the lads playing the Gaumont Cinema in Worcester. On the 4th of September 1964, the Beatles played a one-show performance at the Milwaukee Arena in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, for their ongoing first North American tour. Before our last story, remember to support this channel and our growing community. How? Why? Visit www.simonmas.com/support to find that out. Your help will make the difference, trust me. Thank you! In 1968, the Beatles returned to the Twickenham Film Studios to record promo clips for Hey Jude and Revolution. Michael Lindsay-Hogg returned as director after having worked with the band on the 19th and 20th of May 1966 for the clips of Paperback Writer and Rain. See episode 139 and 140 of What a Fab Day for more info on that. Two color clips were produced for each song, with the work starting with Hey Jude. Paul McCartney took place sitting at an upright piano, John Lennon and George Harrison on a podium nearby playing guitar, and Ringo Starr on the highest podium, behind his drums. In addition to the band, there was a 36-piece orchestra in white tuxedos and about 300 extras of different backgrounds, colors and sets for the coda. In the three takes, the only live feed was that of Paul singing, completely live in the coda and with his own recorded vocals for the first part of the song. But the presence of amplifiers, extras and orchestra meant that the clip could get around the Musicians' Union ban on miming music on TV. In fact, in order to give the impression of the band performing live on the Frost on Sunday program, in which the clip would be first broadcast on the 8th of September, David Frost was invited to Twickenham to introduce the band. Once Hey Jude was completed, it was Revolution's time. Again, two clips were produced, with the band performing in a more usual fashion, with John and George on guitars, Paul on bass and Ringo on the only podium, behind them. New background and lead vocal tracks were recorded to fool the Musicians' Union and allow the clip to circulate on TV. Another promotional idea that almost came to fruition was buying 90 seconds of commercial space on ITV in peak time on the 17th of November to have a commercial featuring snippets of songs included on the Beatles' new LP and a pre-recorded message by Paul or Ringo. It would have been the first time that an album release received advertisement on TV, but it never happened. Anyway, this concludes today's episode. Join me tomorrow for more stories from the four you love. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation.
Simon Mas, music you love.